Well, today, since Mr. Mariwala raised the question of awkward questions, let me start with the awkward questions, so others can take that up. I think the first issue I'd like to address is what has happened to taxes. I don't think there's full transparency on that because opportunity hasn't arisen. I think the world needs to know that September collection was 95,131 crores. September collection taken in October. Then comes October collection. What happens to October collection? Plummets by 12,000 crores. Does the country know that? From 95,131 crores, it has plummeted to 83,346 crores. 12,000 crore decline in 1 month has never been seen before. That concerns me deeply. So here is a question on the table. What will happen next month? What will happen the following month? Among economists, there is a feeling this is not going to stabilize in a day or two. So it becomes an election issue. Because very interestingly, this needs to be looked into. Why has it fallen? My submission on that is because I have taken a dipstick and I find that small and medium enterprises are not able to file, to which I will come for a moment. Why? I have taken dipstick with four major small and medium enterprise sectors, different parts of the country. And I find that small and medium enterprises, there's been 40% decline in some of their production. You take Tirupur, you take Maharashtra, you take Punjab, you take UP, wherever there are small clusters, you will find they are hurting. They're very seriously hurting. And therefore, they have major problems. I'll come to why in a moment. Now, let me go to the next level. I'll just make specific points and then try to bind them together. The next issue relates to revenue to be protected of all states. What is it? Does the public know? 43,013 per month is the revenue to be protected. So August, September, October, November. What has been the revenue protection scenario? One is aggregate taxation decline. I made the first point. Second, for all states per month for 4 years, what did we need for revenue protection? 1,72,000 crores. That's what we needed in 4 months. What have we got? 1,32,941 crores. That means about 1,33,000 crores. That means there is a revenue protection shortfall in 4 months of 39,111 crores. 39,111 crores. What is the total amount that we had budgeted for in the GST Council and the Empowered Committee earlier? We had thought 55,000 crores shortfall hoga. Where will that money come from? It'll come essentially from cess. So 24,000 crores of cess in the revenue area, and remaining from tobacco, from whatever, you know, extreme luxury cars, etc., etc. 55,000 crores for the full year. You already have 39,111 crores of shortfall in 4 months. Now, if you project that, even if you assume some improvement, probably it'll end up as 80,000-85,000 crores, who knows. In fact, predictions are that the way the GST structure is going, to which I'll come in a moment, this could be very, very significant. Now, where will that money come from? Let me take a look at Government of India. What has happened to Government of India's receipts? It's the same story. Government of India's receipts, as expected, from the expectation has sharply fallen. Now, what worries the states, and this is national interest, states, after all, this is supposed to be cooperative federalism. What worries people is that if, suppose, 80,000 crores or 90,000 crores becomes due from the central government as compensation, then what happens? At the same time, Government of India's receipts have fallen. What worries us is there is a constitutional guarantee of compensation. By the way, I want to give you a minute history of how political economy works, for which now I have 6 years of experience. Interestingly, the wording of that constitutional amendment given by the central government was, the parliament may compensate. At that time, Mr. Modi was not on the empowered committee, I think in between. I was chairing it, and our finance minister's consensus was, cannot be made, it should be shall. Now, we were told that, oh, that's only legalistic language, may means shall. If may means shall, make it shall. Now, what was the concern? Why did all of us raise it? In the case of CST, Central Sales Tax, it was given that states will be compensated. And during the previous government, one day we got a letter from the finance secretary saying, from now on, we'll not compensate. Get lost. We didn't want the same thing to happen. So, shall. Second question. Now, see, I would like the chambers to understand how real politics works. The second question was, up to 5 years. Now, what's wrong with that? When you say up to 5 years, that means any time before 5 years, you can stop. So, in the Calcutta meeting of the Empowered Committee, and this is the utility of the Empowered Committee, Empowered Committee fought like hell and said no. And I must say, at the end of the day, when Mr. Jaitley himself came and saw the consensus, we said, no, it should be for 5 years. Now, look at the semantics. Up to would mean any time. For, you cannot move. So, when I am saying Government of India's taxes have not grown the way it was expected to do, it cannot escape from compensation for 5 years because of the constitutional requirement of shall and up to 5 years. In which I happen to have a small role to play. So I made 2 points. One is the concern that huge shortfall in collection in the last month of 12,000 crores. Honestly, I didn't expect that. Now, if this keeps up, even half of it keeps up, you're way beyond the 55,000 crores. Where will the money come from? By the way, this is a separate fund. It's not part of the Consolidated Fund of India. We made sure that it was not part of Consolidated Fund. Because if it was part of Consolidated Fund, only budget mein de sakte. Because it's a separate fund, every month all of us are getting compensation. Because it's constitutional and it's a separate fund. So I've raised 2 concerns. One is sharp decline. The other is I've given you the exact numbers for protection required and how much of it has not been protected. That's a huge quantum. I may mention here that in 2009, Trinamool Congress manifesto said explicitly, perhaps the only party in the country which said, we support GST in principle. And the reason was that small and medium enterprise, Mamata Banerjee felt that small and medium enterprises are today, they have to face 20 different taxes, especially those who have come from districts will know. Other states, 20 different taxes, Inspector Raj, big guys can employ one of the big fours in the world and they can manage and their process, but the small cannot. So I would like to make it clear that in principle support was there and I chaired the Empowered Committee at that time before GST Council. I made sure, first time consensus was developed. When Mr. Modi was chairing Empowered Committee, even at that time I don't think consensus could be developed, he tried. But in Kolkata meeting, historic meeting, consensus was developed. Now I come to my third point. Because there are too much to discuss, so I won't do everything. Is the chamber, like FICCI, CII, I said this in CII in the meeting in Kolkata, are you aware that I hope you're aware that there's a penal code of arrest. Why didn't the chamber speak up? Now, in our VAT rules of state of West Bengal and almost all states, I assume, there is no arrest rule. You can file an FIR if there is a big defalcation, but the tax officer does not have the power to arrest. I am on record in saying that I oppose this penal clause. In 6 years of West Bengal's government that I was there, I am here, there be only two cases of FIR filing in 6 years, and one immediately paid up. That was resolved. Second person was arrested. He switched off all his communication. And he, of course, settled. So there is no reason even to file an FIR. But you have the right to file an FIR. So why this arrest clause in GST? Chambers must understand and must stand up. But nobody did. It's a very, very serious matter. You're giving the law officer the authority to arrest. This is not there anywhere in the world. This is not an IPC, Indian Penal Code. The second point I'd like to make, which relates to I'll give you an example in the how arrest can work. Branded food grains where brand has been defined in a way that it leaves a lot of scope for interpretation. Branded foods. Now what can happen? Taxman can seize his goods, including his books of accounts, and also get him arrested. There's scope for interpretation. Like this, I can give you 10 examples where there's scope for interpretation. So this is something which is there, and I opposed it. It is in the minutes of the meeting. FIR, yes, if you have sufficient case. Go through the judicial process, court of law. Next point I'd like to make is, which relates to threshold application of this provision. What I was able to do in that meeting, along with my other senior colleagues, was we raised the threshold of arrest from 2.5 to 5 crores. And then, of course, above 5 crores, non-bailable, I opposed it, but it was a compromise because some people wanted arrest. Government of India wanted, as presented by the civil servants, and some ministers also wanted. But I'm giving a warning signal that this is very, very dangerous. Next point, anti-profiteering provision. Again, I strongly opposed it. I remember one of the, in the meeting, Mr. Mariwala will remember, appearing before the before us, the chamber said the market will take care of it. If somebody is not passing on their gain in tax, they will have to do so because somebody else will pass it on. So competition will take care of it. That was the argument made. And then the finance ministers immediately said, look, we don't believe this because we have not had experience that business always passes on. Some do, some don't. Now I want to make it clear that this provision in the law is going to have serious problems for a chamber. Since I'm speaking in a chamber, that's what I'm saying with regard to Inspector Raj. What's the experience of Malaysia? They are precisely stuck on this point. They are not able to implement it because it's far too dangerous. But at least I was able to get it recorded in the minutes that this provision must have a sunset clause. Because I had no option. Nobody was going to agree. Nene hona chahiye. Anti-profiteering hona chahiye. Now, at least have a sunset clause. That has been included. Now, this has been completely taken over. The other third point on this, if you do it as an independent authority, like, you know, Competition Commission or something like that. Hands off. What has happened? Government of India owns this. The DG Safeguards is the chairman, is the one which will be implementing this, which is a part of CBEC. What that means is that the kind of autonomy I was seeking in the GST Council, unfortunately, I didn't get, has been made the investigative agency. So DG Safeguards is the investigative agency. Chambers must know that. State screening committees have not yet even been formed in all states. That's a tokenism. But ultimately, the power lies with CBEC for investigation. And what that means, chambers have to fathom out. CBEC, by the way, has 85,000 employees. They would need to be accommodated, and that's why the fight of Dr. Drabu will remember that states should not have up to 1.5 crores. It should be single entity going after the small business. Now, on that, there were three meetings of fight. I felt very strongly that 1.5 crores should be the limit, below which there should be only one authority, like in the state we have in VAT. What was proposed was dual authority. Center will also do. Now, why center? 85,000 people in CBEC, after all, have to get employed. No? So, you have to go to subdivisions, you have to go to blocks, open offices. Aaj nahi hai. Anyway, that got settled there because there was no option. I lost partially. 90% is now with the single authority. 10% is still with the center. So, we came to live with it. I wanted 100% below 1.5. Not to have dual authority. 90% has been achieved, 10% was not. Now I come to the last point. I know my colleagues have to speak, so I don't want to monopolize time. And I'm ready to answer any questions on these particular topics of GST only. Unpreparedness and its consequences. I kept on saying we are not prepared. I want to give you some sense of the e-system. It was in the month of May, and I think Dr. Drabu was saying something on this, I'm sure he'll tell you more. During the empowered committee period, I had three meetings as chairman when I was chairing empowered committee on the GSTN network. Now in May, first week of May or end of April, informally I met up with the professionals as a professional. And I said, what's going on? I'll give you one example. That should suffice. How many invoices are to be uploaded per month? Sir, aap bata sakenge. You do law practice. Huh? 300 crores. 300 crores invoices will have to be uplinked per month. That means 3,600 crores of invoices will have to be uplinked. Successfully. Those uplinks will then look at IGST, interstate trade. You have to sort it out. That's a full circle. I don't want to get into it. Thirdly, input tax credit has to be sorted out from 300 crores of uplinks per month. People don't know this. Then I ask them the question, how much have you done beta test on? They said 200 companies per state. 200 companies per state, you take 20 major states or 15 major states, how many companies? And those must be large companies for all you know. I said, what is your success rate? They said 30% definitely not successful. This is in the month of May. And you're pushing for GST to start on 1st of July. When I took that review, I was very nervous. What is this going to be? We don't know. Now, the return system. We had a GSTR 1, GSTR 2, GSTR 3. None of them worked successfully the way that we wanted it. So what did we do? We simplified everything to GSTR 3B. Has that been fully successful? This is where the tax reduction comes from. Small and medium enterprises are not being able to uplink. Some would say they're not uplinking. But I would say I have taken a dipstick and I find that they are not being able to uplink. Are you aware that manual systems have had to be introduced? In West Bengal, I don't know about Honorable Mr. Modi or Mr. Drabu's state. In West Bengal, no tax activity is done manually or in paper. It's entirely digitized. Mr. Modi can tell you that, others who do business here can tell you. Everything has to be uplinked and digitized signature given by the officer in a DMAT format. for which we have got 4 awards, 3 of them from the central government. I'm happy to say that the first award we got on e-taxation was from the central government and given in Gandhinagar. So my principal secretary went representing Bengal all the way to Gandhinagar and accepted the prize on behalf of West Bengal, people of West Bengal. Now that's the level of state digitization. And here what are we doing? Manual systems have had to be introduced to grant refunds. So are you going to get your refund? Manual system. As the refund module of GSTN is yet to become fully functional. Now we're 4 mahina ho gaya hai. Many other processes are being dealt with manually, like advance ruling, still manual. Normal appeals, totally manual, because the system is just not ready. We have in the process gone back a few steps even from the VAT era. In the VAT era, we had completely digitized. Now we are still grappling with the fact that we've gone back to manual. Now you know what manual means. I don't have to tell business people. Very, very dangerous. As a result, the last point I'm making, repeated changing requirements of GST portal. Now what the vendor will say is that, look, what can I do? Every day GST Council takes a call on changing rules. I must tell you, within the GST Council, none of us do any politics. It's very professional. One day I remember I made 26 changes, suggested 26 changes in the law. And after 3.5 hours of discussion, it was accepted. So repeatedly changing requirements of GST portal has taken a long time to stabilize. Even now, the industry has to suffer glitches and still finding it difficult to correct genuine errors. By the way, you cannot correct genuine errors once you uplink. Nahi ho raha hai. So this final point was going back to manual. Going back to the fact that constantly changing, even tax rates, as you know, have been constantly changed. Now, minute you change the tax rate, can you imagine the implication of that on the GSTN system? For retooling the software, inserting. These are very major problems. They are not simple problems. To me, the political economy of this is what? The small and medium enterprises, I don't want to mention the state, I'm not here to talk politics today, which I can do at length, but I will not. In a state, there is a big problem going on only because of the ground level. So what's the political economy? First, by demonetization, you kill the informal sector. That everybody knows. Then you come to small and medium enterprises with this GST, premature GST launch, without the further earlier 1 year, 1.5 years of homework. What you've done is small and medium enterprises who provide 40% of GDP and 80% of employment, today are in bad shape. I'll give you Maharashtra, 25 lakh power looms. I think about 12 lakh power looms were in serious trouble. 9 lakhs were closed during the demonetization period. I read a report in the newspaper on Surat. I was told 9 lakh power looms, a report said, in one of the pink papers with somebody on the ground. Power loom? 9 lakh, close to 1 lakh, broken and sold as scrap. This is a state that is today under discussion. So I won't mention the name of the state. And result, 1 lakh unemployment. So the political economy of this is, first demonetization kills the informal sector and say we'll digitize and all this. Arey bhai, digitization sikhna hai to Bengal mein aa jao na. You've given us awards to small and medium enterprises across the country. I get everyday representations in my state. So does, I'm sure, my 2 senior colleagues here. They're in serious trouble. And therefore, aggregate tax collection has fallen. Government of India's tax collection has fallen. And I did all my very best in order to be able to help to the degree I can. And there were many times in which I was alone, but other times I got very good support, or I supported other members across political parties. And I must say, in one particular occasion, the finance minister, after 3 hours of what you can call filibuster, you know, which happens in American Congress, We said, let's take a tea break. Then he said, Dr. Mitra, you guys, what do you want? And we had a discussion and we came to some agreement. So my concluding statement is only this. Two companies, one multinational and one domestic company, I don't want to name them. They're both members of FICCI, I assume. They said in a pink paper, we have improved our sales because competition level has declined because the small and medium guys are not able to cope. I can give you the figures. You can check up one of the pink papers. You will see the names of the companies, very big companies. And they say, we are successfully increasing our market share because small and medium guys are not able to cope. So the political economy of this is very, very dangerous. Informal sector, then the small and medium. So my conclusion is, we need to work together. We supported strongly in principle GST Council 2009. We continue to support in principle. But I've given you data on practice. Thank you very much. I think I've taken more time than I was allocated.